Good evening, I'd like to welcome you to the Crockett City Council meeting. It's Tuesday, September 4th, 2012. Thank you all for being here. We're going to begin our meeting with an invocation and a pledge, and I've asked our councilman Larry Robbins to lead us in that. Can you please rise?
Bow here, please. Most gracious Father, we come to you as humble as we know how this evening. Thank you for all of our blessings. Thank you for what you've done for us today and what you're going to do for us. And when it's all said and done, we will give you all the praise and glory. It's in your Son's Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you, Council. Appreciate that. Thank you to all of you that are visiting with us tonight. We appreciate you. Council, let's move to the approval of the minutes. I hope you've had a chance to read. There are actually four meetings worth of minutes. A special meeting August 1st, regular meeting August 6th, regular meeting August 20th, and then special meeting 27th. If there's no additions or corrections, I'll entertain a motion to approve all of those.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. We approve all the minutes as previously stated. All in favor signify by usual voting signs, please. Motion passes unanimously. Very good. Council will move on to our Police Department Manpower and Criminal Incident Report with Chief McKay. Good evening, Chief.
Good evening. Good evening. Mayor, Council, City Administrator. For the Police Department activity in the month of August 2012, manpower was at 15 full time, was 4 in reserve, 2 part time patrolmen. Total manpower hours worked was 2,499. The department answered 535 calls. 36 arrests were made. 126 traffic citations were issued. 110 offense reports were written. 10 motor vehicle accidents were investigated. The department responded to 24 alarm calls, 23 of which were false alarms, and one was deemed no fault false alarm.
Chief, quick question on that false alarm, or it might be geared towards Ron. Is that going to be some of those involved? You know, we were trying to trim that back on false alarm. We have any luck with that? Maybe not.
Maybe not. But each time we get a false alarm and we issue them a citation, it'll go down.
I spoke to one of my night shift supervisors earlier about that and asked him how it was going. He said it's a lot better than what it's getting at.
It's just going to take time, and it's going to take some citations and then and some adjustments of alarm systems, and it should get better.
Okay. It's all right. Already better because it used to be 40 something, 24 this time. It's already better.
I think I remember one that was 70.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It
made
much better than it was.
It's better, but it's no beauty for me.
I heard that there was an arrest made with our copper situation. Is that true, or it was?
Yep.
Okay. Is it believed that he's the one that did the majority of them, or?
That's to be determined. Good chance.
Okay. Thank
still
you, sir.
Investigator.
Any other questions for Chief McKay? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Appreciate
very much.
Thank you.
Council, let's move to item number 5, which is the Fire Department Monthly Activity and Status Report for August. Chief Angerstein, welcome, sir.
Mayor, Councilman Duncan. Chief, I have an activity status report for the month of August. 23 calls within the city limits, 1 structure fire, 1 vehicle, 1 grass and woods fire, 4 accidents, and 11 power line emergencies, 1 lift assist, 2 false alarms. In the county, we had 12 calls for the month of August, no structure fires, 1 vehicle fire, 7 grass and woods fires, 1 accident, and 1 accident with extrication involved, and 2 smoke investigations. Manpower at 23. The total calls for the month of August is 35. Our manpower is still at 23. Do you have any other questions or comments?
Any questions for Chief Council? Pretty busy month. Reasonably busy.
Not as busy as last year.
Absolutely.
I'm guessing the power lines had to do with the few days we had pretty windy days, or?
It's been off and on this month. You get a little gust of wind, there's a lot of dead trees around town.
Well, and too, like in our case, live trees, because they're loaded with pecans and leaves. I mean, dead calm, a big one broke.
Yes, sir.
They're dangerous.
Thank you, Chief.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate you being here, sir.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you, report. Council, we're going to move on to number six, please. Consider an approved request from PJ Lucas for closing South Third Street between East Goliad Avenue and the Camp Street Store and Cafe from 6 p.m. to 12 p.m. midnight on September 21st, 2012, for the grand opening of her taqueria and patio. I know most of you probably drove by there and seen the great deal of work that PJ's put into this new business that she's opened here. In fact, I think it opened yesterday morning. But her grand opening is scheduled for the 21st, and she'd like to have some room there on the street to keep traffic from traveling back and forth during those 3 hours. Excuse me, 6 hours. Sorry.
Second.
Motion made and seconded that we approve the closing of the street. All in favor, signify by using your voting sign. Thanks, council. Motion passed unanimously. Y'all try to go by there if you can and tell her that we appreciate her. We do appreciate those that invest in our community, and I know she's put considerable amount of time and money in her new business. Item number seven, consider and approve an ordinance levying the ad valorem taxes for use in support of the municipal government of the city of Crockett for fiscal year 2013, providing for apportioning each levy for specific purposes and providing when taxes shall become due and when same become delinquent if not paid. Ron, do you have a brief comment on this before we...
Mr. Mayor, this tax rate is the same one that had originally been proposed during prior to the public hearings, the 52109, which is basically that break-even rate that gives us the $15 increase based upon the changes in the tax base. I recommend council approve it.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made and seconded that we approve the ad valorem ordinance levying ad valorem tax. All in favor, signify by using your voting sign. All opposed? Motion passes 4-1. Thank you, council. Council, we're going to move to item number eight, which is consider to approve the 2012 tax roll. Somewhere on this desk, we have a copy of a tax roll.
And it's basically what these are, the summaries. And instead of you looking at books and saying, yeah, they weigh about right, this is actually the entire file on diskette, which is actually easier to have. And it's considerably lighter than the books, and it gives the same information. And basically, if you look at the summary that I put in your book, we've got a net taxable value for real property. It should look like this. And I did a little summary on the front. The next taxable value for real property of $218,117,625. Next taxable value mineral $18,493,690 for a total taxable value of $236,611,315, which is exactly the amount that's in our budget. So it does match up.
Anyone like to see the rest of the tax rolls? Anything else?
What do you like to approve?
Motion made that we approve the tax roll. I have a second.
Second.
Motion made second that we approve the 2012 tax roll. All in favor, signify by using your voting sign. Motion passes unanimously. Thank you, council. We'll move to item number nine, please. Consider to approve resolution for amendments to fiscal year 2012 budget. I think in your council packet you'll see some information about that. Ron, go right ahead, sir.
Yes, Mayor. Basically, this is just a housekeeping measure, and it's we had a number of things change during the year. In the general fund, generally the revenue is up. Key items that went up this year were our sales tax revenue did go up, hotel motel taxes, our permits and fees, and slightly on our power and light franchise funds. We also received $25,000, or will receive before the end of the month, $25,000 was from Union Pacific as well. And the water and sewer, the numbers look lower for water and sewer than previous estimates because we had a major adjustment at the end of July due to a large meter reading problem. And we fixed that. I think that I accounted for it with a lower number, but that's a worst case scenario. And the special revenues, the main thing was we never received anything from Texas Parks and Wildlife. And the only current projects that are actually in the work from a revenue standpoint is the FEMA Crockett ISD shelter project and some library grants. And the expenditures, the main things that in the park were some repairs to the pool, the addition of the ADA chair, replaced the pump, and the police department. Biggest single issue that we bought some materials with forfeiture funds, which were requested by the chief of police, which weren't budgeted. And we also had the unusual expense of the chief's retirement, which turned into a fairly big check at one time. The fire department bought a number of items of equipment based upon the funding we got with reimbursements from FEMA from last year's fires, as well as the approval of council. We bought some tools and equipment in the mechanic shop, which pretty much brings them up to full standard. And the civic center, we did some major repairs to the air conditioning unit, replaced the auditorium doors, which were literally falling apart, and some power issues. But that being said, what I tried to do was just balance it out and clean it up for the audit. There's no major issues.
Any questions for Ron?
I got a couple.
Go ahead.
Sure. What I see, what's concerning me, our revenues were up some, which that's great. But if I'm reading this correctly, our revenues went up, but expenditures in almost every department went up also.
The expenditures went up only in the estimate for it to be a balanced budget amendment. I can't present you a budget amendment that's not balanced, both expenditures and revenue. That's not saying exactly where we'll land, but I put plus ups in the areas where I thought it would be even close, and so we wouldn't have anything go over. At the same time, I made a balance out because I can't have a budget that shows revenue up and expenditures down and not balanced. I had to have the whole thing in balance as a whole.
So what you're saying is you don't really know sometimes what the future is going to hold, and so it's based on
It's my best guess based upon the end of July figures. And again, the expenditures are puffed up a little bit because of the fact that I had to balance expenditures and revenue.
Move, we approve it.
Anything else, Councilman Gomes?
Is this all just through July?
That's the latest figures. I don't have the August figures on which to base anything. I had to use the July figures, and it gets it's pretty much guesswork beyond that. It'll be at least the 10th or the 12th of the month before we close the month of August, and then we would be run out of time for getting a budget amendment done. We'd have to have we'd have to have another meeting.
I can't remember a year that we haven't had budget amendments.
Well, we did one year, and the result, you know, it makes the figures look ugly on the audit because you haven't made any corrections or adjustments.
So you predict it'd be pretty close.
It's as close a prediction as I can come up with, given the fact that I'm projecting 2 months out.
We have a motion to approve the budget amendment. Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion made and second to approve the budget amendment for fiscal year 2012. All in favor, signify by the usual voting sign. Motion passes unanimously. Thank you, Council. Item number 10, consider an approved resolution agreement with the Texas Department of Transportation for the temporary closure of the state right-of-way for Christmas on the Square. And I think in your council package, you'll see that information. Every year we're required by TxDOT to pass a resolution. Christmas on the Square is going to be...
It'll be November the 17th.
November 17th.
So move, we approve.
Motion made second to approve the closure of the square for Christmas on the square. All in favor, signify by usual voting signs. Motion passes unanimously. Thank you, council. Now move to item number 11. Consider and approve candidates for the Texas Municipal League Intergovernmental Risk Pool Board of Trustee Elections.
And this is different from the last election did. This is for the Intergovernmental Risk Pool and not to the TML board. And when we looked at this, we recommended the incumbents in each of the place, in each of the four places that are listed. That would be Greg Ingram, city manager of Plainview in place 11, Larry Gilley, who is the city manager of city of Abilene in place 12, Byron Black from the appraisal district of Johnson County in place 13, and Pat Norris of Nortex Regional Planning Commission, Region 5, for place 14.
Don't know any of them, but I'll take your recommendation.
Neither do I.
I hope they like it.
I don't know.
I read them on the...
That's not a paid position anyway, is it? They're volunteer?
No, those are volunteer board members of the risk pool.
There's one Larry in the S.
He's got to be on. We have a motion to approve. Second.
That's second.
All in favor, signify by usual voting sign.
Thank you.
And we trust these folks will do a great job on the Intergovernmental Risk Pool Board. Item number 12, consider and approve an ordinance amending chapter 19, utilities of the Crockett Code, amending section 19-37, paragraph F1, bulk water sales to increase the fee for selling bulk water, providing severability clause, containing repealing clause, and providing effective date. As you know, council, we looked at raising our bulk water rates after some of our council were concerned about that, Ron.
And effectively, that's just as discussed in the budget workshop. The basic service charge went to $100, and the fee is for $9.50 per 1,000 gallons for bulk water.
What were the old rates, Ron?
It was $50 and $4.75. Okay. So we effectively doubled it for bulk water.
Well, we have a motion to approve the change to the ordinance and a second. Thank you. All in favor, signify by your usual voting sign, council. Motion passes unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you, council.
I think that's a prudent thing to do. Item number 13, consider and approve an ordinance amending chapter 10, garbage and trash of the Crockett Code, amending section 1029, increasing the rates for residential and commercial garbage collection, amending section 1030, increasing the charges for pickup services of commercial garbage containers, providing a severability clause, containing repealing clause, and providing an effective date. Ron?
Mayor, council, guests, as discussed and during the budget workshops, this is a 10% increase across the board in all rates. The residential garbage rate goes from $18 a month or $17 a month to $18.70 per month, and the residential commercial rate went to $30.25 per month. But again, it is a straight 10% increase, and that also goes for our containers as well.
Any questions?
And our rates for both our garbage collection rate as well as our containers remains very competitive with any city as far as lower prices, and our garbage collection rates are lower than residents outside the city, and our containers are less than the commercial providers.
Any? Second. Motion made second that we approve the increase as stated in the order. All in favor, signify by usual voting sign. Motion passes. You against it, Larry?
Yeah. No.
Hold against it. Motion passes 4-1. And I do want the public to know that the city council and mayor does not get a discount on water or garbage or sewer.
Or taxes.
You're welcome to come pay my water bill anytime. My $75 a month and the council's $50 a month, I know, does not even pay probably their water bill.
That's so before taxes, $50.
My water bill.
All right, thank you, council.
I guess where my water bill is, where I work.
Oh, I wouldn't want to trade with you. Okay, council, move to item number 14. Please consider and approve an ordinance of the city of Crockett, Texas, amending chapter 11, health of the Crockett Code, to add section 1122 to provide for appeals to the district court, providing a severability clause, containing a repealing clause, providing an effective date. Ron?
Mr. Mayor, the only change to this, and I talked to the city attorney about it, and the modified copy will be here tomorrow, but it's actually adding section 11.2-23, not 22. Wherever you, in the ordinance, you see it in three places, in the header, and in the two statements below in section one where it mentions section 11.22 of the Crockett Code is hereby added, and 11.22 appeal to district court, it should be 11-23. Other than that, I recommend it be approved as written. As drafted.
I'm gonna move that we approve it, but we need to amend the motion to make the correction.
Correct.
Okay.
So we have a motion to approve based on the amendment of the ordinance, the correction.
You need to do the, you have to have a motion on the floor before you can amend it, then you amend it, and then come back and approve the amended motion.
We have a motion to approve the ordinance, then we'll ask for a motion to amend.
Yeah, but you've gotta have order on the floor, so somebody's gotta second it.
Has anybody explained what this is about?
What this is about is, it goes back to when I went to Dallas, or when I went to Austin for the meetings where they talked about the building and standards and the nuisance abatement ordinances statewide, and some cases that had happened in the courts, in federal and state courts, particularly with Dallas County and the city of Dallas, and from the lesson learned from those was to clarify in each of your ordinances the appeal authority, so there's no doubt in the resident's mind that where the appeals are allowed and how do they appeal, and this strictly does that. And this particular one, it allows for the appeal of the ruling to district court if necessary.
Okay, so we have a motion on the floor, a second, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I move we amend the motion to change section 11-22 to section 11-23.
Second.
Motion made second to approve from 11-22 to 11-23.
Yes, sir.
All in favor, signify by use your voting sign. Motion passes.
Okay. Now you might vote on the amended motion.
Now we'd like to get a vote on the amended motion. Do we have a second on that one?
Second.
All in favor, signify by usual voting sign. Motion passes. Now, thank you, Bill, for keeping us straight with that. Item number 15, a lengthy reading, please bear with me here. Consider and approve an ordinance of the city of Crockett, Texas, amending section 5.427.1 of the Crockett Code, providing for notice of substandard structures to owners, lien holders, and mortgagees, providing for verification of owners, lien holders, and mortgagees of substandard structures, providing for filing orders of the building and standards commission with the city secretary, amending section 5429 of the Crockett Code, providing for securing substandard structures from unauthorized entry, providing deadlines to comply with the orders of the building and standards commission, providing for demolition or removal of substandard buildings by the city, providing for relocation of occupants of substandard buildings, amending section 429.1A of the Crockett Code to delete the provision for city repair of substandard buildings, amending section 435A of the Crockett Code, providing for notice of requirements to comply with orders of the Building Standards Commission, adding section 5436 to the Crockett Code to provide for appeals from the Building Standards Commission to the District Court of Houston County, Texas, and for abatement of orders of the Building Standards Commission during the pendency of the appeal, adding section 5437 to the Crockett Code, providing for the issuance of administrative search warrants on probable cause, providing for a severability clause, containing a repealing clause, and providing an effective date. And that was with one contact. That's pretty good. Go ahead, Ron.
And Mayor and Council and guests, this is all about that same set of court rulings. And again, when I handed you out the read-aheads, hard reading, but on the first page, for example, of this one, the only thing that really changed in section one, down at the bottom of the page, the very front end of the paragraph where it says by personal delivery, they added that phrase to that paragraph that talks to by personal delivery or certified mail, return receipt requested, or first-class mail, the proper notice. They added the phrase of by personal delivery. On the second page, subparagraph 4, they added a paragraph there that the notice must contain the street address, the legal description of the affected property, the statement that the structure is substandard, a brief and concise description of the substandard conditions, a brief description of the public hearing and action recommended. Stuff we were already doing, but it's also now in the code the way it's supposed to be. The remainder of that page is essentially the same. On the third page, you go all the way down to where it gets to under item B, hearing order. When you get down to sub item 6, that was added. Everything else was there. It added the phrase, order that the structure be secured by the owner or lien holder from unauthorized entry within 30 days. The idea of it is so it doesn't turn into a place where unhealthy activity might occur. Subparagraph C was added. The order to repair or demolish or remove a substandard structure must require that the repair or removal or demolition be completed within 30 days unless the owner or lien holder establishes at the hearing that work cannot be reasonably performed within 30 days. Our Building and Standards Commission has always been very lenient with the property owner to give them that leeway. And the rest of that paragraph was all new, that basically talks to up to 90 days. The next, everything else on that page is the same until you get down to section 3, item A, 1, bow legs there, where it talks about demolish and remove the building. You actually removed a section that was in error in the book that said the city would repair the building, whereas we're ordering to demolish and remove the building at the expense of the city and assess the expenses on the land on which the building stands, if necessary. Next page. In section 5 and 6, those are brand new sections, and again, it goes back to the requirement to clarify the appeal process, and it's our case. For our ordinance, we already had the district court in there mentioned in several places, but this adds it into the same chapter, so you're not looking through our code book to find it, that requires the owner or lien holder can appeal within 30 days after receipt of a copy of the order. Meaning, this also puts the requirement on the property owner that if you are going to appeal, get started on it. And at the same time, you do have an appeal through the district court to protect you as another layer of protection for the property owner. On section 6, the ability of the code enforcement officer, fire marshal, or health officer to actually go onto the property with probable cause to inspect, determine if it is a substandard structure and action needs to be taken. And those are changes that were added.
Any questions or comments for Ron about this? I think we've had a pretty successful run with our substandard housing ordinance. I think we've been able to make some headway with it. I appreciate their, even becoming a little more toothy, if you will, with some of these new rules and beefing it up a little bit.
I got a question.
Go right ahead.
Just in my opinion, a lot of this property is probably going to be in my precinct. As far as relocation,
all it does is it provides the power to have the occupants move out if you feel the building is unsafe.
We're not
going to be like what was the guy in what was it, Legree, the guy in the bad guy movies where he would, if you don't give me the deed to your ranch, I'll throw you out on the street or tie you to the railroad track. None of that. Snidely Legree, that's who he was. But anyways, unlike Snidely Legree, we're not trying to put anything in there that makes the city the bad guy. It's more or less just to give us the authority to move. If they're living in a totally unsafe structure to order them out. So that you don't have a situation where they live in an unsafe structure and it falls down on their heads and somebody gets killed and then comes back on us because we didn't take appropriate action.
Any other questions, comments?
We approve.
Second. Motion made, second, we approve the updates to the ordinance. All in favor, signify by using voting sign. Motion passes unanimously. Thank you, Council.
I knew that was a long.
A painful reading.
Yes, it is.
Okay, we're going to move on to item number 16, comments from our audience or council, and Sandy Decker's back. Good evening, Sandy. I see you're interested in clarification on the peddler's ordinance, if you will.
Yes.
I just have one comment. You know, the conversations we've had with our city attorney, and I haven't had much with our city council, is that the ordinance is written as clear as we can possibly be. It does not affect consignments. I think you're aware as well as we are that if during Christmas on the square you decide you want to lease some space for booths, that's totally your prerogative. I don't know that if that's within the spirit of Christmas on the square, but nonetheless, that's your option. I told Ron before the meeting, and I want council to think about this, the idea that you had of bringing some booths up on North 4th Street, I think is an excellent idea to bring some foot traffic the direction of your business. I would even go so far as to see if the city's property, which we own this building and lot across the street from us right here, the old Family Medical Center, if that could be used for something during Christmas on the square to attract some attention for you guys, I think we would offer that to the chamber. I don't know if they can get anything going entertainment-wise this year, but I don't see any reason why we couldn't offer that, because it would be great to get some more foot traffic headed up your direction on 19 and get some more people shopping that direction.
Okay. Mr. Mask, Ron, Bill, all the rest of the council members, thank you again for having me. Yes, I understand what you're saying, where you're coming from, and my issues today are the fact that I think it needs to be clarified. I'm not a lawyer, but maybe I missed my calling or something. But I still see all these holes in it, and I think it needs to be clarified, because one thing is at the beginning of the old ordinance, it states, or it describes peddlers, solicitors, and then itinerant merchants. And all through that ordinance and the revised ordinance, all it mentions is peddlers and solicitors. It never mentions itinerant merchants. So there may be a definition up there, but it doesn't cover that. And also in areas where it talks about charitable organizations. Mm-hmm. And although classified under the same tax code, a charity and a nonprofit are not the same. And I think that needs to be clarified, that if you're a nonprofit and or charity falling under this particular tax code, then you are exempt. And any of your vendors or whatever. Or you can even say in there that the chamber is exempt from this on that particular day. But also Mr. Duncan had drew, and this confused me, drew a downtown map and said that the reason for that downtown map, one of the reasons, had to do with Robinson's. Has anybody looked at the downtown map? The vendor at Robinson's came in and set up, and that our businesses downtown were complaining about it. He's outside of the downtown map, that's wrong.
No, it actually says on or adjacent to the street that delineates the boundary, which means on either side of that street, which constitutes the boundary, is in. Otherwise, you'd have to draw a boundary not only in around the downtown, you'd have to draw it into the residential neighborhoods to cover it.
I'll have to go back and read that, because y'all sure. Did draw in a lot of residential areas to cover it in there also. But I still think you need to go back and revisit it.
Well, I mean, I'll conversate with him about those questions.
I mean, I would like to sit down one-on-one with you, Wayne, and show you what I'm talking about, and so you can understand my confusion. It's because what's going to happen, you're going to pass this, and then later on down the line, someone's going to come in and say, it doesn't pertain to me. It doesn't say anything about me. It doesn't pertain to me. And they're going to want to do whatever they want to do, and you try to enforce it, they get a lawyer, and now what kind of mess are you in?
Yeah, and I appreciate that. The best we can do is to use our city attorney for our ordinances, and we have, and we've depended on him to give us a good, solid legal opinion on our ordinances, and
Well, let me sit down with you at
I'd be glad to. Yeah, let's do that. Call my office and we'll get together and talk about it.
You know, give you some areas which I'm talking about.
Okay.
And then you can ask the lawyer.
Be glad to.
But what about this and what about that?
See if there's some exceptions that perhaps he didn't think about.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. I'd be glad to. Thank you. Thank you for your interest in that. That's all the comments we have. Any council members have any comments?
I got one. We might have mentioned this in times past, but I would like to see in our next budget year to start job performance evaluations. Maybe get away from this 3% across the board pay raise. Give pay raises where they're due. I want to see that. And I looked in the handbook, browsed through that, and it said that was in 2003 that was going to be looked at. And obviously nothing's been done.
We did do them when we were doing merit-based pay raises, but we haven't had a merit-based based pay raise in several years, and the last increase was a cost-of-living increase. That's the reason why it was 3% across the board and had nothing to do with job performance.
I'd like to see it, especially the ones that answer to us. Mm-hmm. There are three. I would like for the council for us to start doing job performance evaluations. After that, I guess down to the department heads, that'd roll down to Ron.
Sure, that's a good idea.
I just, you know, if the guys are doing good, we need to give them a pat on the back. And if they're not, we need to have a paper trail to connect to where the deficiencies are.
Let's try to do that on an annual basis. I think that's a good thought.
That's fine.
Anything else, council? Well, thank you all for being here. Appreciate you. Meeting adjourned.